What's up, guys, and welcome to Put a Sock in It podcast. I have a very special guest with me today, and I mean, fortunately or unfortunately, I think it's fortunate that Larray is not with us today.
Fortunate. I'm just kidding. I love Larray.
Today we have the amazing Carter Gregory, aka
oh my god,
the Carter B.
What an intro. Woo! Thank you.
What do you think the majority of people know you by? Carter Gregory or the Carter B?
Definitely the Carter B.
It's kind of iconic.
I feel like when I'm out, people will be like, oh my god, Carter B.
It's your stage name.
And I'm sure. Like, oh my god, wow, yeah, that's me. But my middle name is Benjamin, so it like makes sense.
That's where the B comes from. The Carter B.
My dad always called me Carter B.
I love that.
But then it was a play on like the Carter 3, Lil Wayne. Because I'm like,
oh,
you know.
Duh.
I'm also a rapper.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Let's pull up those pics of Carter dressed as Lil Wayne from last year's Halloween.
Actually, that was the hardest Halloween costume ever.
It looked good. It looks great.
Yeah.
I wonder if you'll be able to find it. Carter Gregory, Lil Wayne. Here we go.
Nope, that's just
there's a Hollywood face.
on my birthday.
They're all you. They just look so similar.
Isn't his name Carter too? Lil Wayne.
Yeah.
So that's why.
I knew that. I don't know why I acted surprised. I think I knew that. Fire.
Oh my god, he looks good. Who is that guy?
Okay, so as some of you guys may know, Carter and I are good friends. We talked about it before, and we don't quite remember when we met, or how it happened. You're just kind of in the scene. Like if you're in the scene, you're in the scene.
Oh wait, I remember. I think it was.
It was out. It had to have been out. Like there was no way it was at like a
and
house.
And then you came home with me, and we had that.
That's crazy. That's crazy.
No, I truly. How did we meet? I really don't remember. But
had to have been out.
It had to have been like a party.
Had to have been like high.
It had to be with. It had to be with. It had to be with Dixie and Charlie.
Yeah.
Somehow. Because I was...
It was early on.
Like it was
when
early
I first
on.
Came out.
Yeah. But I remember because I met Dixie and Charlie first. And then... So I had to meet you.
Just
through them
somehow in the scene. Same. Yes. Like, if you're in LA and you're kind of like... You know.
I mean, it was love at first sight.
Right.
We locked eyes and...
Duh.
Just knew.
And just... it was there.
The birth of Koa.
But to be honest, we didn't quite... I don't know. It wasn't until... Somewhat recently, like up until
like
a few months ago, that we became like good friends.
Solidified.
Yeah, before it was like a hey, like sometimes like text that kind of thing, but we would never like hang out like that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But now it's got to a point like I think after New York when we shared that Harry, I think the Harry moment was the.
I mean that Harry night was. The best night.
Harry just brings people together. I cannot stress this enough. Like, this is why I'm such a big fan of
him. It was truly... I mean, because we talked about this. Like, I saw Harry at Coachella.
Right.
But it obviously wasn't really, like, paying attention. Also, like, wasn't there.
It just wasn't the same.
It wasn't the same.
Like, when he first came out at Coachella, I was like...
He's incredible, obviously. But I didn't get the full Harry experience.
Right.
Until we were at Madison Square Garden.
Mm-hmm.
And that was just the best night ever. And when we did the... Mosh pit,
with Huey, everyone. Boot and Scoot.
Come on, please.
And we all randomly, I think it was to Matilda when we locked arms and just swayed and back and forth. Like,
I mean, it was crazy seeing all the fans how they like had everything, they had choreography
something for like every song,
and were so eager to teach it to us.
Yeah, like a genuine, like out of body experience. Like, when then we left that night and we were like, probably one of the best nights. Of our lives. Like,
literally just, one of the best nights. And like, then we kept the night going because then we had all that other Fashion Week stuff.
We did. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we were just filled up on energy because it was just like...
We were on a high. And we went back to your room and you changed and I didn't have any clothes. So I just stayed in the
That's room. Crazy. Is this what this podcast is going to be?
Larray 2.0. I love this. This is great. Better or worse than the next show you guys went together to see Harry?
In LA, different experience.
Different. Like when we went in New York, we...
Spontaneous.
I mean, it was so spontaneous.
Like day of, literally.
And I had zero expectation. We were just like going into it and I was just like, well, this is going to be fun.
Word for word, you were like, I'm not the biggest, like, Harry
fan.
Yeah.
No. I love Harry, but I'm like, I don't actively listen to Harry like that. And I I didn't dive into Harry's house, like, properly. So went in it with, like, little expectation. And I think what changed it was we were in the pit. And the pit energy was just so infectious and, like, such... It's the highest energy I've ever been around. And... that's when I was like, oh, fuck. Can we cuss?
Yeah.
Okay, great. I was like, oh.
Nothing like it.
Fuck.
Yeah.
I was like, Harry is iconic. Now I get it. I'm like, this guy is larger than life, superstar, incredible performer. And yeah, that was like being in the pit. So like being in LA, we had seats.
Mm-hmm.
And
went with Spotify. And we went with Spotify. Had the whole glamorous experience.
Love Spotify.
Love.
But I definitely, like, in LA was wanting to chase that same level of high energy that we had in New York.
But I'm also glad that we did both.
Yeah.
Due to the fact that now we know that...
the pit's better.
I want to always be in the pit.
Yeah. We always want to be in the pit.
I also do have to say, I mean, like, working in music and seeing LA shows versus anywhere else in the world, people in LA... it's just an LA show is always going to be a little bit different energy because LA people were always just, everyone's a little too cool.
Everyone cares too
Everyone's
much.
A little too cool.
Exactly.
And so it's like, when you go to a show anywhere else, it's like, I just feel like people, they're there for the artist. And it's like, it's such an event. It's such a, like, we are here. We are the fans. We are going to make this the best night ever. Whereas in LA, it's like people are a little bit more laid back.
Yeah,
a little more
like,
reserved.
Cool, taking video.
Yeah, and it's like, oh, we're here, Harry, yeah. But like New York was like, wow.
Yeah.
People were in it.
No one
people
cares.
Were in
literally.
It. No one cares.
No one cares.
No one cares.
And I think that's one of the coolest things about, like, I mean, I think I touched on it on a recent podcast with Larray about talking about, I, up till about a year or two ago, like when I came out to LA, really, was when I then kind of found like a love for concerts and like I never was huge into concerts because I never really went to any growing up. And then
you just went to soccer games.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Love those. We'll always be a fan of those.
We love soccer.
But concerts, it was one of those things where I don't know. I went to the Kendrick Baby Keem.
How much fun. That was so fun. I forgot we went to that show.
Fun. So however, fun. Hear me out.
Uh-oh.
Not one of the, like, I would rather not be in the pit. And one of those.
For
I
that
would,
show. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
that
why,
makes sense.
Like, it just, it's such, different artists bring different crowds. And with Harry, it's like his demographic is whatever. All age ranges, like, whatever. Yeah. Like, people go there to have a fun time. Like, he literally addresses that in the beginning of his concerts. He's like, my job is to perform and entertain all of you. Your job is to have as much fun as possible. Like, he literally says that. And
with a rainbow flag. Tied around his neck.
Exactly. Love and him. It's just like so inclusive and it's just everyone's just there for just a good time.
What an ally. Harry, you are such an ally.
But also, like, I think it also helps that he has, like, when you go to his concert, it's such a roller coaster of, like, emotion because he has sad songs. He has upbeat songs. He has, like, he's a bit of everything. So you'll literally, like, we'll go from booting scooting to moshing to linking arms and kind of just like feeling it. And it's
to
just like
medicine.
It's so funny.
Two
to medicine.
For two.
Two for two.
Wow.
Well, I'm like, you're two for two still.
Did he do it more when you went?
No, I'm like two for five.
Oh, wow. I'm
just still a
two.
Pretty good ratio.
What do we mean two for five?
So,
how many times he played medicine?
Do you know what medicine is?
It's an unreleased song.
Unreleased song that he only plays for some concerts.
I didn't know any of this.
Yeah.
And when we were at New York, when it happened, it was like, you are the luckiest people on planet Earth.
The only people that have heard it.
I mean, he does it at, like, random shows.
Yeah, no,
but
it's
like, the fans were like, this is a very big deal that it's happening right now. And I was like, ooh. Like, but no idea.
It's like a rare occasion that he'll do it. But I don't know. It's
is
almost
it a slow song?
No. It's like a crazy, like.
It's a banger. It's
what
really
kind of,
good.
Is it like rock?
I don't know. It definitely feels like more alternative.
Yeah, but it's a great song and it's very high energy and he usually finishes with it. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because it's such like a experience that everyone wants to have that like people will give you hate online, like we were seeing, like, I remember after people were like, I hate that Noah got, like, Noah and Carter really got.
Didn't you put it in your caption? You're like,
of course.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You're like, I'm 2 for 2 medicine.
I said, I literally captioned my photo 2 for 2 on medicine, by the way. It's just like, I knew it would like poke at some people, but it's like,
you'd freak out too. Yeah.
Right.
And I texted my friends who are like big, hairy people. And I said, I was like, oh my God, you guys, like, medicine again, 2 for 2. And they both responded, like, we don't want to talk to you anymore.
Yeah.
Like, we've never seen medicine.
Like, I get it. I get that side. Like, if I...
I mean, that's how I'd be on Beyonce if she did something.
Of course.
Like,
you have the gatekeeper. And I'm like, look, I get it. Like, I know I'm lucky.
I gatekeep Beyonce.
Yeah.
No one knows Beyonce like me.
Except her and I.
We won't get into it.
Yeah, we won't.
We won't get into it.
I think everyone has that person.
You know what? Let's get into it.
Okay.
I'm pissed.
Yeah.
No, I'm not pissed. I'm the biggest Beyonce fan that there is. And I will stake a claim in that. She's the reason I work in music. She's the reason I fell in love with music. From like 5 years old, Destiny's Child, like No, Part 1 and Part 2. I was like, oh my God. That's my earliest form of like, I love music. And it was because of Beyonce, Giselle Knowles Carter.
Would you crumble if you met her?
I have met many a people in my life, and I feel like I've reached a point where I'm like, I know how to
hold yourself.
I know how to hold myself. I'm like, I stay very composed.
Do you want to meet her? I can
B,
set it up.
B, come on out. She like comes
in. Beyonce, come on out. She comes out of the wall. She just comes out of this.
She floats. I think I would be able to hold it together, but I just think internally I would be a shell of myself. But I hope that I would just be able to like
hold it together,
have a normal conversation. Yeah. But I don't know. Ricky just met her.
Yeah, we talked about that.
Yes, we did. And Noah is like best friends with her. So.
I am not best friends with B.
So annoying.
And but, Jay.
And Jay. But Noah has hung out with them.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Mm-hmm. And just said it to me very nonchalantly one day. And I was like...
No, okay, so how this came up was so funny. We were like at my house, and this was like not too long ago. We were with a group of friends, and we were talking about like people... Of course, it started with... Guys, I don't want it to come off obsessive. It just kind of like...
Started with Harry.
I don't want it to come off
obsessive. And I met Harry, yes.
But you have not.
Which is annoying. I have not met Harry. Yes. But...
We would photo together, please.
Please. But we were talking about people that... Like, if someone met... If one of your friends met them, and they, like, mean that much to you, like, it would genuinely, like, make you annoyed. Like, if, for example, us seeing medicine and Harry people being like, oh, I've never seen it. Like, that's so annoying that you got to see it. Like,
yeah.
That whole same emotion, in a sense. His was Beyonce. Mm-hmm. Curtis was Harry, because Curtis, like, loves Harry. He's been a diehard Harry fan for so long. It's crazy.
And yours is Ronaldo?
No, I don't have...
Or Messi?
I don't think like these freaks.
Wait, but
I
you
think
have...
Like,
but you have Ronaldo, Messi?
Yeah, if you met Ronaldo, I'd be like, tell me about him. Like, how is right. he? Like, I wouldn't be like, ugh, like, screw
And you already
you.
Met David Beckham.
I did. That was nuts.
So you've, like, met yours. I know who you
I've met a lot
are.
Of mine. But, like, I still haven't met Harry, and I'm
not
mad
man.
About it.
I know who he likes.
But it's funny because it came up with Harry, Curtis telling me that if I ever met Harry, he, like, wouldn't be friends with me, like, that kind of thing. And I was like, that's ridiculous.
Yeah, that
He's
was...
being a lot. And then Carter was like, yeah, no, mine's Beyonce, like, if either of you. And I was like, I thought he was joking, because I swear I could have... And I was like,
we've never talked about it.
Yeah. And I was like, you don't, I was joking. Like, I was like, yeah, like, I didn't know if he was joking, but I was like, you do know that I've like met her multiple times.
Yeah. And the multiple times.
Yeah. That was yeah. got him. That was, yeah. Yeah. Like,
it was just rude. It was rude. It was like, not, and it wasn't just like,
I was like,
met her.
Really?
It was like multiple times. And like, we've sat down for like 20, 30 minutes, like talking.
I was like, ooh.
Me, her, and Jay.
This never came up.
Me, B, and Jay. I'm like, don't call her B.
Like, I'll see myself out
don't
the door.
Don't call her that.
Don't call, you don't know her.
Wow.
But that's how that came about. But okay, so.
Wait, do you have a favorite concert you've ever been to?
Ooh.
I've seen Beyonce live 14 times. I've been to every single tour.
Wow.
And some tours multiple times when I was like able to. I think my favorite.
You would have made it to every single
okay, wait,
one
yeah, favorite and then favorite Beyonce tour.
Ooh.
Having seen...
I mean, my favorite concert is definitely... Honestly, my favorite Beyonce concert is Coachella 2018. Like, it was just so unmatched. And going to literally every single one of her tours since Destiny's Child, I've never seen her put on such a performance spectacle with such a clear narrative and theme. Like, the HBCU college, like, it was...
crazy.
So Black-centric, so incredible. I've never seen anything like that in my life.
Yeah.
And I still watch that Coachella performance on Netflix, like...
oh, my God, yeah, same.
Weekly.
You really said it was spectacle. Like, you don't see that with artists.
You don't see... you, there is never... I mean, I've never seen a performance like that, ever. I think that's the greatest performance of all time. Yeah. Actually, no, I'll say it. That is the greatest performance of all time.
I think I can agree with that.
Sorry, Harry.
Okay, outside of Beyonce.
Not Harry.
Outside of Beyonce?
Before you answer this, I think something... look, I know, like, a little subtle flex. Our friend, Montero, knows how to put on a show.
Lil Nas' concert was amazing.
It felt like we went to a Broadway show.
Yeah.
Like, genuinely, he has such a cool...
yeah, there was, like, different...
it's an experience. It's like, so cool. And, like, I just want to really throw it out there just to, like, show more praise to him, because I think he is so talented. And, like,
yeah,
the way he's able to create with, like, visuals and just, like...
yeah.
Everyone that was at that concert, I feel like, left and was like, wow, that was cool.
Yeah.
Like, just experienced something.
Yeah, he was amazing.
And I feel like not every artist can say that, or not every fan of an artist can say that after seeing one of their concerts.
And that was my first time seeing him live. And I was, like, so... proud of him, because he absolutely... I mean, he's just such a performer too.
Yeah,
he...
the choreography and all that is
everything.
Nuts. But all right, answer.
Besides Montero, I would say who I recently saw that I was blown away by, because I've never seen a show like that, also was Rosalia.
Oh.
Holy fuck! It was like... it was so minimalist. Like, her staging was so minimalist, but the way that, like, she was able to create such... like, an intimate and, like, very unique performance with just herself and her dancers was insane.
Yeah.
Because it was the whole Moto Mami project. And there was this one, during one of the songs, I don't remember what song it was, but, like, literally her dancers, because, like, it's, like, a bunch of the, like, content and stuff was, like, her on motorcycles. And so her dancers literally formed a motorcycle, and she was, like, on top of them as, like, a motorcycle. It was just, like, the coolest... thing I've ever seen.
The charades.
Just like literally, literally.
Motorcycle. You're just like,
just like, what am I, guys? Yeah, but no, Rosalia was incredible.
She,
her vocals, like the dance, she was amazing.
She's very talented.
Yeah.
I think that's really cool.
We need to get you to more concerts.
I know. Yeah. I know.
I will
kind
say,
of like a loyal customer to
Fletcher. Are you here next week? Or are you leaving?
Frankie? Am I here? Yeah.
He's here next week? Yeah. Great, you're coming to Fletcher.
Would love it.
Yes, absolutely.
We love Fletcher.
We love Fletcher.
Does she live in LA?
Yeah.
Because was it after, in New York, I know this is kind of all over the place, this isn't like chronological, but like, in New York, that one random night when we all hung out and it was all of us, Fletcher, and then...
Kelsey. Ballerini. Yeah.
Yeah. What a fun group of people.
Yeah.
And like, that was my first time meeting Fletcher, and she, like... such a cool, down-to-earth, like, both of them is really cool.
She's the best.
Yeah, and that was...
and I'm super proud. I mean, she's the first artist that I signed, and I'm super proud of her because she's sold 100,000 tickets.
She's been killing it lately.
Yeah.
Yeah,
her touring story is out of this world. And so we have two nights at Hollywood Palladium next week.
I want to come.
Which is 8,000 tickets in two nights. It's crazy.
I feel like people don't understand how insane that is to sell out. To sell out 100K tickets
in a year.
In a year, like, that's... and for a new artist,
a lot of people.
And truly, like, I mean, she just released her debut album this year, but like, a lot of people would be like, oh, she must have like had a massive hit to like be able to sell out these tickets. And I mean, she's done incredibly well, but we haven't had like a runaway hit this year. The last really big song, major song that we had was this, her single Bitter. But it's just a testament to like her fan base and real artist development that she has just like trailblazed, and her touring is just insane. It's really insane.
You know what I realized? We haven't actually talked about what Carter does.
I was literally just about to say, I was going to let him finish his thought.
I don't even know what I do.
Okay. So where I was going before we kind of rambled and just like talked about like our fun experiences together, there's many more, but we had Yeah, I was going to say, people know that I know you. People know that we hang out and all that stuff, and we've been hanging out more lately. Mm-hmm. So I know all the answers to these questions, but I'm going to interview you as a person who I'm going to act like totally oblivious and...
First time meeting.
Okay, so I'm going to ask these...
It's like a blind date.
Yeah. Yeah, wow. Exactly.
Okay. Except we're actually dating, sorry.
So if I were to never know you... Shut up.
He almost missed that.
I had to throw that zinger in there.
Yeah. That's good. I'm just going to purposely miss him. From now, if you throw out a few more, I'm just going to keep going. Okay, so as someone who's never met you, mm-hmm. Hi, I'm Noah. What's your name?
My name's Carter Gregory.
I love that.
AKA the Carter B.
What do you do?
I am the vice president of A&R at Capitol Records.
Okay, we did some deep diving, and we mm-hmm. saw, like, to be fair, I didn't know this. The VP, I knew you were in A&R.
Yeah.
But I didn't know what the VP meant. And I was going to mm-hmm. text you, and I was like, I'll just wait for the podcast. But, like, so that's big.
Yeah, what does that entail?
It sounds like a big deal. Sounds like a lot of responsibility. Which, I mean, it is. But, yeah, I'm just so, I mean, in our department, we have... Our head of A&R, EVP, SVP, VP, you've got your directors, managers, scouts, coordinator, whole department of A&R. As a VP, I'm, you know, tasked to scout new talent, meet with talent, sign the talent, and then once you have signed said artist, you are responsible for all of the creative, musical, the albums, the EPs, the singles, plugging them with songwriters, producers, helping go back and forth on notes and editing the songs and making sure that they're with the best collaborators that they can be to put out the best art that they can.
Love that.
It's truly like my dream job. And I feel very, very grateful to... I mean, I always knew I wanted to work in music. Like I said, Beyonce, 5 years old. I love music. I've always wanted to work in music. I used to think that I wanted to be an artist manager. And then like growing up and interning and being around artist management, I was like, okay, I am far too selfish of a person to manage an artist. And I can admit that because like being an artist manager, it is a 24/7 job. Like you are just nonstop. But what I truly love the most about music and working with artists is the actual music creative process. Like that is where I thrive. That is my bread and butter. That's my passion. I love nothing more than just immersing myself in the actual music creation. Mm-hmm. I feel really, really lucky to have found my calling and my passion because like, although the music industry being an A&R is a very like hectic job, it doesn't feel like work all the time because it's actually my passion. Like I'm never sitting here like, ugh, I hate this. I'm like, even on the hardest, most busiest days, I'm like, wow, I'm so grateful because I fucking love music so much.
And you get to do it.
And I get to do it.
I love that. And this is all at Capitol Records.
All at Capitol Records.
Big label.
Huge. Are you overlooking the touring too?
Not as much. That's more our agencies, like big CAA.
So like after the album's released, you kind of take a step back?
I don't have to take a step back. Uh-huh. I just, like Fletcher now. Fletcher's on tour. Currently, she's been on tour, I mean, the entire year. But like, I mean, we've been making this album for the last 2 years. But even while she's on tour, it's still, okay, we're going to put out a deluxe album. So when she has some days off of tour, cool. Let's get her in the studio, finish a few, 3, 4, 5 more songs that are going on deluxe. And then once she's finished with the music, then I'm like, okay, cool. I'm taking it. I get it mixed. I get it mastered. Make sure she's cool with everything. Approve it. And then we ingest it. And then the label, we do our thing in terms of, I mean, as an A&R, you're basically the liaison between artist and label. Mm. It's like, so once we're done with the music, I then take all the music and I'm like, okay, marketing, okay, commercial, okay, digital marketing, okay, radio, okay, promo, okay, publicity.
Work.
Here's the project. Here's Fletcher's vision. Here's said artist's vision. Let's blow this thing up as much as we can. Yeah.
Are you helping with music videos too?
We definitely are involved in that side, but I always err on the side of the artist is the captain of the ship. Mm. And we are just here to make sure the ship gets there safely to wherever we're going.
Right, right.
So it's always the artist's vision first, and then however we can help amplify. So once the creative for the video is there, then obviously like our creative team, our video department, we're gonna go and source the right directors, creative directors, styling, whoever we think could be best to make the vision come to life. So I do personally, like, I love to have my hand in like every department.
Yeah.
Because I'm just a very hands-on A&R, and something that's super important to me is that whatever artists I work with or sign, like, we're homies. Mm. We're gonna hang out. It's not just business. Like, you are my friend. We're gonna go out together, because making music and like this, it's art. Like, it's such a vulnerable experience and process for these artists, and like I want to be able to be extremely vulnerable with them,
right,
in order for us to like really be able to make the best product that we can.
So I like to be
involved in all of it.
Wow.
And I feel like being close to an artist, like prior to signing them, or even in the process of signing them, I feel like being close is just only beneficial in terms of, you know, sometimes you're so close to something. And as someone who, I mean, both of us, everyone in this room likes to create, and as people who like to create, sometimes you're so close to the project where you can't take a step back and like look at it from a farther view. So it's nice having someone that knows you that can be like, hey, I know this is your vision, but like, what if we did this?
And absolutely,
as long as the artist isn't stubborn and isn't taking that in like an offensive way that you're trying to add your input, I feel like it can only help the vision in the long run.
Absolutely.
Is getting another perspective. And so, I don't know, I've seen, there's been times when we've gone out and I'll be like, oh, who's this? And you'll be like, oh, this is an artist I'm looking to sign, or this is some. And so it's like, I feel like that only helps as well, is having that relationship with an artist, because then it makes them more comfortable. Because I could only imagine being a talented artist and having every label like pulling you some kind of direction.
Yeah.
And it's probably overwhelming, and you probably just want someone to like hang out with and get like a good crew. And then when you realize that, oh, this isn't just business, like they're actually cool here.
Yeah.
I feel like it's only a bigger incentive to sign with that label.
Absolutely. And like something that you just said is when labels oftentimes can pull artists in so many different directions. I never want an artist I work with to feel like they are just like a machine, or like they're just like a product.
Yeah.
I'm like, that's not what this is about. You're make, like, music is, it's like, to me, it's the one unifying thing that as humans that we all have, that we can, everyone can connect over, whether you're whatever race you are, whatever language you speak.
Universal, yeah.
It's universal. Like, if there's a song that we both love, you can connect with someone over that. And so for an artist to be able to make art like that, I never want them to have to feel like, oh, I signed to a major label, now I'm just a product. No one really cares about me. They just want to make the most money and benefit off of this. I never want an artist to feel that way. So that's why it's super important to me to establish a real connection and a real relationship with the artists that I work with, because I want to be in it with them for the long haul.
Yeah. And I think, I don't know. So how long have you been in A&R? Like, how long have you been in the...
I've been at Capitol for 4.5 years. And before that, I was at a management company, songwriter, producer, management company called Milk and Honey for 2 years, where there I was, that was when I kind of also learned like, management is not for me, because I just like cannot handle having to deal with someone's life at all times.
Being responsible for someone. Yeah.
Cause I'm like, hey, I got a lot of shit going on in my own life. But even when I was at Milk and Honey, I think what made me make the leap to A&R was that I was the day-to-day for this producer, Oakfelder, who's done a lot of, he did Sorry Not Sorry, Demi Lovato. He did like the whole Demi, he's done so many of Demi's projects, and done a lot of Kehlani. He's amazing. But when I was working with Oak on the management side, like after he would have a session with like Demi or Kehlani or Zara Larsson or someone, I would always like hit the label A&Rs who like worked with the artist, giving my opinion on the song that they just did, which was as a day-to-day manager, which was totally not my place. Like, I'm not the A&R with the artist.
Yeah, I probably didn't go unnoticed though.
But people were like, dude, you're giving great insight and opinions.
Right.
this isn't your place, but what you want to be, like, you want to be, but. So you should shut up, shut the fuck up, but you, like, you want to be doing A&R, like, this is what you should be doing.
Right.
And then I met Jeremy Vernick, who's now the head of A&R Capital, but he's signed Halsey, and we just became homies, and then he was the one who was like, you need to come to Capital. Like, you're already doing A&R, like, you need to just come actually do it.
Who was the,
just with the title.
Who was the first artist you signed to Capital?
Fletcher. Fletcher was the first artist I signed.
Love that.
And you knew her beforehand?
I knew her before. So her manager, this guy, John, him and I went to college together, UNC Chapel Hill. So John and I knew each other for years, and Fletcher went to NYU, and he knew Fletcher because they're both from Jersey. So I've known Fletcher since I was like a senior in college. And then when I moved out here, we became fast friends. And I was at Milk and Honey still at the time, and she was unsigned, but I was always like helping her set up sessions and just like wanting to get her in with people. And then when I finally made the leap to Capital, that was like the right timing for her to want a major label offer. And it just happened. It was very like serendipitous the way it worked out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you look for in an artist when you're looking to sign?
I mean, I feel like it's changed so much.
Well, that's what I was just about to ask. I was about to say, you've been in... The reason I asked, like, how long you've been doing this is just kind of a little background that from the time that you started till now, I'm sure the music world has changed
drastically.
Drastically. And yeah. I mean, I have no clue, but I just assume due to, I mean, how much the world has changed with TikTok and
TikTok. No
that
way.
Silly thing. but I can only imagine how much that has changed the music industry.
Yeah. It's flipped you it can, on its head for sure.
You can literally. One video can blow up and bam, next day you're signed by a music label. Like, it's crazy to think.
Yep.
And as an A&R, I'm sure you are scrolling through TikTok for talent.
And I'm needing you to send me things.
Yeah. And I love music and I will always be happy to help. But talk a little bit about how much it's changed and how from the beginning to now, how much like the music industry has evolved.
I mean...
Or been stunted.
Like you said, what do I look for in an artist? I feel like this hasn't changed. I still always chase after that gut feeling, that like visceral reaction when you see an incredible artist perform or when you like hear a song for the first time and you're just like, holy fuck, like that was insane. Like, who is this? That is still at the forefront of like what I chase when I'm looking for new talent. And once I like hear a song or see an artist and after meeting them, I'm always making sure like, okay, what is the work ethic like? And like, how bad does this person want it? Like, is this like a, oh, I'm doing this for fun, but like I have plan B and C, or is it like, no, there's no other option. Like, I am an artist. I'm a superstar. Like, this is what I am born to do and I'm going to make it happen regardless of if you want to work with me or not.
Right.
That's when I'm just like, okay, cool. There's definitely something there. This person has that fire. But now, I mean, research has forever always been a part of A&R. It's always been a part of scouting new talent. And when I say research, I mean like, you know, seeing data move with artists, seeing numbers pop up regionally or like where are people listening? Are we seeing something bubbling over here? And also obviously with social media, research is even more integrated in our A&R everyday lives because, you know, we see songs pop up on TikTok, Instagram Reels, SoundCloud, wherever it may be. And, you know, we have to look at that data to see what's happening with said artist. So now I'm like, it's definitely a level of, I still always want that creative gut feeling of like, regardless of if there's something, this person has a song that's flying on TikTok or not, like, is there a real artist proposition here? Like, is this actually an artist that we think can be here for the next 10, 20, 30 years? Like, cause that's definitely what I want. But you also have to look at the research and be like, cool. If an artist is playing a song in their bedroom, just playing straight to the camera guitar and it flies the fuck off. And all of a sudden we're seeing tens of thousands of video creations a day on TikTok to their sound, whether it's sped up or slowed down, whatever it may be.
Right.
It's like, cool, we have to look at that and like meet the artist and get in there because that research is a part of A&R.
Right.
So it's like we look for a lot of different things.
Yeah. I feel like it's so interesting because there's probably so many people sitting at home right now, maybe even watching this, that has, you know, have put out a video of them singing and just like it just didn't build enough traction or whatever it may be. Maybe one did and now it's like, what next? Like, how do I take that next step? Like, how do I get discovered, if you will? And it's like, I feel, I don't know. I think TikTok has, in a way, given people this outlet to kind of put their stuff out there in such an easy way that, like, it's not, with YouTube, it's a bit more difficult because it's hard to get someone to click on your video and
you
be like, here's me doing a cover. And
yeah,
you have to click on the video. Like, TikTok, you can just scroll and it's there and it's like, you have no choice but to listen.
Right.
And I feel it's good and bad because now there's so many, there's a lot of competition. You know,
so much.
So many people.
More than ever before.
More, like, there are so many people with good voices out there where I feel like you have to have more than just a good voice now.
Yeah.
And I feel, you know, it's one of those things, like, you were talking about, like, it's a gut feeling, like, if they have it or not. And it might have to take more than just a good voice. And I think TikTok has really, I don't know.
Wasn't it used to, be CDs you'd send in as demos?
That was a little before my time.
Okay.
Yeah, that's like,
so it was a long time
fashion.
But
the way it's evolved is nuts.
Yes, for sure. For sure. And it was, there was so much more, such a level of actually going to live shows for unsigned talent. Like, really being out there in the streets at night, shows every single night a week, like, just looking for new people.
That's crazy.
Right. I was going to ask, before or after CDs, but before TikTok, what was the thing you guys would do?
I mean, yeah, there was a level of, like, I mean, we had streaming still, obviously. When
so
I
you're
came
like
in.
Surfing like SoundCloud, so, YouTube, like,
oh,
all that
yeah.
stuff.
Which is still a thing, which still, is still obviously what we do. But I feel like, yeah, when I first came into Capitol, it definitely was, I was going to shows at night a lot more than I do now. But
it's
it's so
I feel like
fun.
That's fun.
It's so fun because I was like, I loved being able to be, it's like, it's so intimate. It's like, you're right there with the artist. Like, and cause for a lot of these unsigned acts, you're going to be in rooms that are maybe like 200 cap, 250.
Right.
So it's not like you're in like a big arena, obviously, because most of the times, 9 times out of 10, that artist is already signed if they're performing in an arena.
Yeah.
But like, it's, you know, that level of being able to just see someone just like put their art live out like that and then meet them afterwards and like have the opportunity to actually speak with them after performing. If you were very captivated by the performance, like I love that so much. But now it's different because obviously there still are live shows and we can do that. But, you know, it's we're on our phone so much. So much is social media
makes it so easy
base. It's we're finding so many more talented people just by scrolling through TikTok.
Yeah, is TikTok the number one way of finding artists?
It probably hurts to say it, but like, probably.
I know.
It's
because the traditional space, it's like, it's probably looked down upon. It's like, oh, this is ridiculous. But then it's like,
it's
where a lot of things discovered now.
Or is it the easiest way to find?
It's definitely one of the easiest today, especially just because with these, when a sound starts to bubble, it's like we have the data to see, okay, this sound is moving. Who's the artist?
Right.
Like, who's behind this? Which, you know, we didn't have that. That wasn't a thing before.
Right.
But I still, to this day, like, I honestly don't find myself scrolling on TikTok that much. I like really love when someone like sends something to
it's
me.
My job. Yeah.
Please. Yeah. That's Noah's job. I love when someone sends something to me. Cause I just like, I don't scroll on the app that much. Cause I more so, I love being on like SoundCloud. I love being on Spotify, Apple Music, and just like doing deeper dives there and just finding shit that I really love.
It's like crate digging.
Yeah. Like I love that. I love that so much. And for me, I'm like, it lets me like listen to a full song rather than just like a 20 second to 30 second clip on TikTok.
Cause there's so many, there's like things that, I mean, even right now there's like a huge trend going around of like this like riff challenge. And then there's, we'll get on that. There's also like duets where people can do like open mic and they can like sing a song with an actual artist by just duetting them. And it's like people like Charlie Puth has really embraced this. Even like Luis Capaldi's now on TikTok, but he doesn't even post singing stuff. Luis Capaldi's hilarious.
He's just the funniest.
He's just
guy
like ever. A relatable, like,
yeah.
He's just funny.
Also signed to Capitol.
Also signed to Capitol. Love that. But speaking of this new trend that's going along with the, I'm sure you guys have seen it with the riff. I'm not even gonna try it. No.
It. Oh, you got a little lick.
It's a CeeLo Green song. Tell us about that, because.
Yes.
Yeah.
An artist, Natalie Jane, that I recently signed. She is
before or after this video.
It was before the video. It was before the video.
Oh, yes. I thought you discovered it through.
It was before
not
the video.
Cool. Not as cool.
It was before the video. I know it would have been cooler if it was like.
I know. No, although you hopped on that quick.
I signed her. I signed her a few months ago.
Oh, that's perfect.
But I mean, so it's very, very. She's my most recent signing. It's
so how
very,
cool is
very,
that? Like seeing an artist you just signed have a video that's just
incredible.
Like. Hey, what's it at? Incredible. Probably like more than 100 million.
Yeah. Oh, I think it's at like 100. It's like 115 million views right now.
It's been one of the most trending videos like that we've had in a while. Cause like not many things like blow up like that lately.
And you know what's so crazy about this? And like, cause Natalie, she's the coolest girl ever. Incredible voice. But, and this is what like blows my mind about TikTok.
Yeah.
Nothing, none of this was planned. There's no label marketing. There's no influencer spend. There's nothing behind this.
You put the video down in a garage and press play.
Natalie loves, just because parking garages have great acoustics.
Right.
She's an incredible, powerful voice. Natalie loves to be in a parking garage and just sing.
Love that.
So this is a regular TikTok for her. She just puts up her camera and is doing a cover of Crazy. And this is the response. And she, we were talking the other day and she's like, it's so nuts because like, I mean, her next single comes out on the 18th in a week. And she's like, I'm not like promo. This wasn't a promo for my single or anything. This is like me doing a cover of a song. And it's just crazy to see the response.
Yeah.
But I love that because it's also like, you don't have to do much. You don't have to plan all these things.
No, it went viral for a reason.
For people like, to like really gravitate towards
it. That's the thing. Like with, I mean, as someone who's not in the music industry, as someone who just kind of like does my thing in other lanes, it kind of goes back to, you know, I have done brand deals here and there. I have done even song promos. I have done like worked with brands.
Yeah.
All these things that require so many boxes ticked. Like there's so many things that are like requirements in making this video. And I'm like, just give me the like, I wish it was as easy as sending me the product, telling me, we trust Noah's creative vision, have him do a TikTok about it. Like, what does he think will blow up? As opposed to, hey, can he touch on these? Has this script? We want to hit directly to camera. We want, you know,
make
no
sure he's
other,
holding it in his left hand.
No other labels. And I'm just like, let it be organic. And I promise you it'll do better than, hey, guys, this is so-and-so. Like, buy this now. And it's like, what are we doing? And so,
that, like, that cologne one you did, I liked.
Thank you.
That one was good.
We had to reshoot that one quite a bit. That
you kind of killed it, though.
Thanks.
It was kind of a slay.
Thanks. but that one was pretty... I mean, Armani, thankfully, had a very open, like...
Yeah.
They basically were like, here's a few things that we need to touch on. Other than that, it's Noah's vision. And I was like, love that. And so it's nice when you get the creative freedom because it's so hard to... It's tough. And I'm assuming as an artist, it's probably hard to bottle all your creativeness and all your vision and, you know, having it kind of, almost restricted. And it's like, well, just let me do my thing. And I promise you, I know what people want to see as opposed to being like, if it's too addy or if it's too just like, you know.
Right. And that's why I try, because I mean, TikTok obviously is such a new platform. And for artists that I've worked with who have been around prior to the TikTok uprising, you know, I feel like for some of them, it was a little harder to understand the platform and like get comfortable with it.
Yeah.
And so something I'm always saying, I'm just like, just put no thought into it.
Right.
Just like try things, be yourself. And I feel like the less planning that we do to try to make it something, the better it will go.
Exactly. I feel like when there's too much behind it, it's like,
I feel like people can see through that.
It's like, and it's not, it's not, I don't know. There's so many things. Exactly. And I think with TikTok and like everyone having it, like as much as people, you know, like in the traditional space, kind of look down on everyone has it.
Everyone has it.
And
I think it's fun.
It's fun. It's great. And it's very innovative. And it's like,
even for myself, like outside of like music or whatever, I'm just like, I think it's fun as fuck.
And I think the thing that goes the most viral nowadays is the relatability aspect of it. Yeah. And you don't see, like, I don't know, when you see a super crazy like A-list celebrity hop on TikTok, their video is going to go viral. It doesn't have to be them, like, it'll probably go less viral if it's like a reposted ad that they did. Right. It'll be something like, hey, I'm on TikTok now. Like, I don't know how this thing works. And people will be like, oh my God, like, welcome. And oh, it'll go viral.
So cute.
Someone recently who is like interesting to see on TikTok, and his stuff is hilarious because he like responds to people, interacts, and it's so authentic. And like, no one from his team is telling him to do this.
Who?
Penn Badgley.
No way.
Do you know who Penn Badgley is?
Of course.
From you.
I haven't seen from Gossip Girl. Hello. From Dan Humphries.
From you. He is hilarious.
I haven't seen his TikToks.
No, it's great. And like after this, I'll have to show you some because it's literally like, it's just funny.
And someone asked him to do a dance and he actually duetted it and did the dance.
And it was great though.
You're like, what?
Oh, we love Penn.
Yeah, but it's just cool to see that. And I think, I don't know, almost showing, like, anyone can go into a parking garage.
Yeah.
And do this with one of their friends.
I really want to hear you sing it.
Not me. Not anyone. But I'm just saying, most people have access to a parking garage somewhere.
Yes.
However, if they were to do this with, like, high-end production and all that, people would be like, oh, this is so cool. Like, unfortunately, I'll never get to do anything like this. Right. It's like, you can do this.
Exactly.
Like, you can literally go and do this.
That's the point. Yeah, it's like, this is what she does on the daily.
It's so cool.
And then like, it's like anyone can do it. I feel like that's why it feels so relatable.
Anyone can do it.
She sounds insane.
I was literally going to say, anyone can do it, but it's the videos like these where you hear a riff that anyone that listens to it is going to get chills.
Right.
Right.
Or want to play it 100 times. Like the top comment on this literally says, I've listened to Mind about 100 times.
Yeah. At some point, it's got to be relatable. But at another point, you like, it goes viral because it's so good or because it's so like, addicting to watch, or it's just there's got to be something else other than the relatability. But
Natalie's a phenomenal voice,
right? So, we can't take away the credit of wow, like that was unreal. But
I feel like if you're not gonna sing it, we gotta at least hear it once, like play it for our fans
like this.
Oh, go for it.
You want to sing it?
No.
I want Noah to sing it, but
one last call. No, only once. It's gone.
Let's hear it.
So is her friend signed too?
I don't think so.
I'm sure someone's reaching out now because her part was great.
Yeah, she killed it too.
I mean, a friend of ours as well. Benson Boone, for example.
Benson.
We love Benson.
We love you.
Benson is one of the most talented, like, again, so I can't say, I know nothing about music. I love music.
You know talent though.
Benson's very talented.
He's very talented.
And obviously he won on the American Idol. Mm-hmm. And I mean, the way I found out about him was funny because he had mentioned me in his audition. And that went like viral because Katy Perry like said my name because that was kind of cool. And then
Police.
And like Luke Bryan was like hyping me up too. So it was like kind of cool. And then he DM'd me like right after and was like, hey, I don't want you, like, if that airs, I don't want you to see that and think like anything, but I think you're really cool and like all that stuff. And I didn't see that till after.
Yeah.
And then I saw that he was out in LA. I was like, yo, let's go grab something to eat. Cause I think you're like, I don't know, seemed like a good kid, like really talented. And then we actually met, was a great kid, like really liked hanging out with him. And then the next week you were like, hey, I'm at dinner with like an artist that I'm looking to sign, like that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then it happened to be Benson. You're like, oh, you guys know each other. And we're like, we sure do. Sat down, we all like kind of hung out. And then now whenever he's in town, but it's rare now because he's all over the world killing it.
Traveling, touring, absolutely killing it.
But like, I think you know more about his experience on American Idol. Like, I don't really know much about what happened.
Yeah.
But he dropped out?
He dropped out. Yeah.
Okay.
Do we know why?
Because he could have very well won it.
We were talking, and not to speak for him, but like we were talking while he was still on the show very early on. And he told me, he was like, I'm ready to start like releasing my own music.
Is that how you saw him? Oh, is that how you came to see his stuff on American Idol?
I reached out to him before it aired.
TikTok?
I saw him on TikTok.
Okay.
Yes.
Because he did both. So that's how you get even more exposure.
100%.
Yeah.
And because he was doing covers on TikTok. One of my favorites was he did this cover of Duncan Lawrence Arcade, which is an artist that I signed. And he mashed it up with Shawn Mendes' Mercy.
Cool.
And so it was like Arcade going into Mercy. And it was so good. And so I just reached out to him.
He's very talented.
And I was like... Because I also sent it to Duncan, the artist, who sang, and Duncan was like, this kid's insane. And so I reached out to Vincent being like, hey, I, A&R Duncan, we both love this. Like, what's up? What's your story? And then we started talking. We FaceTimed, and he was like, I'm actually like on American Idol. But I think I want to actually like start releasing my own music now. Like, I don't want to wait. Because if he stayed, he would have had to... You know, do the entire American Idol
is like a label in and of itself, right?
I mean,
you kind of have to like sign your rights over
for some period of time. I don't know exactly how it works now with their contracts, but he would have had to stay there for a minute. And I think that he was just at the point where he's like, I'm seeing this traction on TikTok. I'm seeing that people are creating videos to my sounds. The exposure is already happening.
Yeah,
his audition like more exposure from American Idol, but like he was at the point where he's like, I know I can write songs. I'm ready to start going for my own original music.
Yeah.
And I think he made the best decision.
Great decision.
Yeah.
And it's amazing because, I mean, he's a hard worker. Like when he's not making music, he's making TikToks promote his music.
Yeah.
And like, he does it in such fun ways.
They're unique. It's not just like, I'm sitting in my car.
No, he's quirky. Like he makes funny videos and like
really funny videos.
Tries to make trends out of his sounds, and it's amazing. And another thing that I thought was just so bizarrely, like, I don't even know if that's a word, but like
bizarrely, we're making it a word.
It's trademarked. Just such a thing that's just so talented. He paints and like he draws all of his cover art.
Yeah.
For like his album, for his singles, like, and I thought that was amazing. And it's just really cool, and I'm just like proud of him, like genuinely, because it's just so cool. And like, I wish I had his voice, and I tell him that. I'm like, you're so annoying for that, actually. So it's like
just a few voice lessons.
Yeah. So he's
easy. We'll get you in there.
He is very, very talented. But that's just another way. Like, that was not too long ago, so it's still a thing where people will go on to get exposure.
Yeah.
But I almost think that he got more exposure from TikTok than he did American Idol.
1,000%.
And it's crazy to think, but. Yeah, it's nuts.
Wait, when you think of Kelly Clarkson, what do you think?
American Idol.
Right.
I do think American Idol.
When you think Carrie Underwood, what do you think?
I don't know what show she was on, but a show that
American
she won.
American Idol.
She was on
American I think a Soul Idol. Surfer, Carrie Underwood.
I feel like it's...
I don't think of American Idol, I think
Soul
Carrie
Surfer.
I don't even
she
know.
She was in it. She's a teacher.
What's Soul Surfer?
Oh, that
I
is
mean,
crazy.
Wait. Oh my God, I love Soul Surfer.
Bethany Hamlin. Wait. Dude, have you never seen that movie of the?
Is it with the blonde girl?
She gets her arm.
When she gets her arm bitten off.
By the shark.
It's a true story. Bethany Hamilton.
Oh, Soul Surfer.
Duh.
I thought you said goal.
Right.
Worcher. I love Soul Surfer. Yeah.
But yeah, no, I was. Just, she's just like.
Yeah. No. Totally.
And she's like stunning.
My point was like most of these people that come out of these shows, when you think about them, I feel like you think about the show that they came from. It's rare that you get an artist like Harry. One Direction, Fifth Harmony, where like
true.
When
I
you
never
think about, them,
think about you, I never think about
me
X
neither.
Factor.
Me neither.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's yeah. But it's one of those things where it's like I'm sure Carrie Underwood would not mind if people were like, oh, I know you from American Idol. I'm sure she'd be like, yeah.
Also, I feel like
that's
such...
where I was discovered. Like, it's not like an offensive thing. It's just like,
and that was such a revolutionary time.
Like she was
for that type
of
show.
American Idol at that time was like the way to do it. Okay, so being an A&R, like, how many artists do you have under your belt right now?
I think 7.
Is it a lot to keep up with?
It's definitely a lot to keep up with.
Okay.
Yeah, for sure.
And we've touched on a few, but one that we have not talked about, and she your most recent signing?
Natalie's most recent signing.
Natalie. So just before that.
Amelia
Moore.
Amelia Moore.
extremely talented.
Who you've met.
Who I've met.
A few times. Yeah. I swear I see your name everywhere. She's insane. I swear I see your name
everywhere. This part's so cool. Top comments, the rest of the music industry should be scared.
Yeah. was that one of the top comments?
One of the top comments.
Fuck yeah. Yo, they should that's be sick. That's my girl.
What a cool look. What a cool voice. What, like,
I'm literally so,
are you,
and so inspired by her.
Yeah.
Are you excited for her career?
I am so excited for her. She, you know what's, her story's so cool too, because she's from right outside of Atlanta. And she was homeschooled her entire life.
Whoa.
And grew up in a very, very religious household. To the point where, like, she never listened to Kanye, Beyonce. She never listened to, like, any pop culture.
Yeah, like mainstream.
Mainstream. No mainstream artists.
Wait, why?
Because her family, like, they listened to a lot of, like, Christian music.
Right, okay.
Music.
Wow.
Oh, interesting.
And then once she turned 18 and went to college, that's when she said that one of her friends showed her, like, Kanye's discography from, like, top to bottom at the time. And she was just, like, her mind was blown.
Yeah. How old is she?
And she was just, she's 20. And she was just opened up into a whole world. And she was like, what am I doing? Holy fuck.
She dropped out?
She dropped out and then moved to LA.
Was she making Christian music? Before
I think when she was, like, in high school, she was.
Dabbled in it.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then once she got out is when she really started, like, songwriting and then realized, oh, my God, I'm an incredible songwriter.
Yeah.
She really is. She is. I mean, that's something I can say about almost every artist I work with. They're all such incredible songwriters. But, yeah, Amelia just, she's one of those artists where it's a very kind of, like, once-in-a-lifetime type of art that I have never experience before. Mm. Like, to work with, obviously I've seen those artists.
High praise. Like,
I think that she's gonna be one of the biggest artists.
She's a gem. Yeah,
she's a gem. And what's so cool about her too is that, like,
so unique,
she wants to write for other people too.
Dope.
She's like yeah, get me in with whoever, and I'll, like, she literally wrote a song for Fletcher and they got in together and that song
was incredible. So cool.
Yeah. And then she was on tour with Fletcher, open for her too.
We should, like, get in the studio sometime.
I mean, yeah. Let's hook it up.
Do you make more money by writing songs for other artists?
You can, yeah.
Yeah, I guess it depends on who the artist that's buying it.
The term's ghostwriter, right?
I mean,
what's that term? Because that's like writing for someone and not.
And then, like, you wouldn't be credited.
So Drake.
Why would someone do that?
I didn't say that. What?
Because for some artists, like, it's way cooler. I feel like this is also, like, more of a hip hop thing. It's way cooler if we just think that artist wrote all of those bars by themselves, instead of, like, oh, there were four other writers who were in the room who also wrote some crazy songs that we love.
But why? I feel like that's a very, I don't know. I feel like that's a very unselfish thing to do, is write a song for someone else and be like, take all the credit.
Yeah, but
does it work like that? Or is it more of like, can you buy it off them and be like, yo, don't tell anyone?
I mean, yeah.
Like, how does it work?
There's definitely levels of contracts that can be put in place to where, like, your name won't be anywhere, but you'll be paid out for sure.
Oh, mm-hmm. Okay. Oh,
so, like, are they in the, if they don't want their name anywhere, does that mean their name doesn't get into the song credits?
Yeah, like, their name wouldn't.
But they'll still get paid.
They can still.
Yes.
Oh,
interesting.
T. Okay. Most of the time, so that makes more sense, because I was like, why are they just like?
But a lot of
I was like, what a good dude. Like,
but a lot of the times, like, I don't work with any anyone who's like a ghostwriter. So it's like, if Amelia's going to write a song for said artist, then like, it's going to say Amelia Moore.
That'd be really cool, right, to be a ghostwriter. Yeah. Because like, if you're in the music industry, but like not, and like, if you know, you know, like if you're in that industry and you know this person's a great ghostwriter, but no one knows their name, mm-hmm, but they're still getting paid because they write all these amazing songs.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the way to go about it. Because like, fame, right, like, I feel like a lot of people don't want fame.
Yeah.
With good reason. Because yeah, they see like people that are close in their lives, like artists that they work with that are famous.
And
like,
maybe that's not what they want at
probably
all.
Probably be miserable, or yeah, probably just not the life they desire. And yeah, it's like, rather be rich than famous. And that's like, it's crazy to think.
Hey.
Hey.
Bring me the money, honey.
For real. I give two shits about the fame. Have you started shopping for the holidays yet? You know most gifts don't go bad, right? The only thing that'll go bad between now and December are the crowds at the mall. Right now, you can shop early, skip the stress, and snag some of the best deals of the season on something everyone will love. Premium audio products from Raycon. When you're looking for a gift everyone needs, or a stocking stuffer that's not a candle for once, Raycons are the way to go. Their wireless earbuds, headphones, and speakers offer premium sound, useful features, an almost custom comfortable fit, and up to 54 hours of battery life. And as the person gifting them, you've got to love that they start at half the price of other premium audio brands. Plus, Raycon makes it easy with holiday gift guides for everyone in your life. Mom, dad, coworker, fitness, lover, gamer. Everyone needs a pair of Raycons in their ears, whether it's for listening to music, taking work calls, or blasting a workout playlist. You know what everyone doesn't need? Two little white stems hanging out their ears. Luckily, Raycons are sleek and stylish and come in a range of colorways to match anyone's style. You can find Raycon in stores now, like Kohl's or Walmart, but let me tell you right now, you're always going to get the best deal when you use my special link, buyraycon.com/sock. Right now, go to buyraycon.com/sock and use code EARLYBF to get 20% off site-wide. That's 20% off any Raycon product, which almost never happens. Or save even bigger and get 30% off Raycon's exclusive holiday bundles. That's code EARLYBF at buyraycon.com/sock for 20% off your Raycon purchase. buyraycon.com/sock. Apart from being an A&R, VP wow, A&R, yeah, we went into deep, that. I feel like I learned deep, so much about music.
Wow. I don't even know what I said.
And now I want to imagine. apart from being an A&R, people who follow you on social media are probably very intrigued and like, that can't be the only thing he does, because due to your network, like your network is crazy. And like, as someone who, like before I knew you, I was just like, what does he do? You know, like it's interesting because apart from that, you are also,
who is the Carter B?
An influencer, if you will, you know?
Oh
you
my have, God, me?
You have yourself quite a following. Ugh. And it's,
Noah, this video.
What are we doing? Your idea. I love this.
I feel like we need love to it, explain what happened what here.
Is okay, we'll touch on this. We'll touch on this. Okay, so not too long ago, Halloween. Literally, what is it? Like two weeks ago.
Yeah.
When did we come? We came up with this idea when we were at dinner with me, you, Stoss, Sydney, Victoria.
We're at Horses.
And Drew. Mm-hmm. And we were at Horses. We literally were just sitting there and we were like, Halloween's coming up. What do we do? And we were thinking
like,
about
we like, should do it like a couple's costume.
No, no, it was more of like a, it was more of
buddies,
a, it was, a, it was a friend's costume in terms of how do we do something with like, it'd be kind of fun if we did some kind of like iconic, you know, black white duo. Yes. And so I was like, let's do that. You have Men in Black, basic cliche.
I'm pretty sure it was Stoss who said,
I think Stoss.
I think it was Stoss. Yeah,
Stoss is like kind of the queen of Halloween.
She like was like, I, "Do this." And yeah, we were like, okay, please.
So we eventually, or yeah, she came up with Mr. Incredible and Frozone, and we were like, "Bet, let's do yeah, it." She put us in touch with the people that she uses.
Yep, to make costumes.
To make the costume. These were custom
from scratch.
From scratch.
I mean,
we went and got our measurements done.
Noah's was better than mine. Mine was a little too tight.
We should address the gun. Frozen doesn't carry a gun.
Oh yeah, he definitely
doesn't carry a gun.
But Carter does.
No. He did that night.
we should address the ice pick that you got.
Well, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know what. I don't see anything.
So let's see. One of the top comments says, it looked at me first.
So first of all, we had a great
night. The ice pick. I can't.
First of all, we had a great night and it was very fun. We went to Kendall and Kylie's party.
Yes.
At Chateau something.
Uh-huh.
It was great. Before that, literally, we should talk about how we all met up at Stassi's house.
Yeah.
And we were going to take the party bus to go to the party.
Yeah.
We were like, you guys go ahead. You know,
we'll meet you guys there.
We'll meet you guys there. We stayed for an hour after to create these masterpieces, which we call TikToks.
And it was honestly best part of the night.
It was so fun. If you want to go back and see us,
Noah's like a director. Like full on, like Stop. Had a vision,
knew what he was doing.
Like I could have never, like if it were me, I would have been like, okay, let's just stand here and like say the lines, I guess. But Noah like had a full vision of like, no. So then I want the camera to be here, and I want you to grab my shoulder, and I was like,
I love creating. I think it's so fun.
I'm like, I get it. This kid knows what he's doing.
No, look. So I go in between like, I don't know if it's time periods of being creative or. Some of my videos are just, I put it down. I'm just like, this is me. You know, like, this is one of those things. Like, I'm not putting any effort
like,
in.
Like, cuff it.
But, like, some
He gave nothing.
Yeah.
Beyonce, cuff it. Our king gives nothing.
That was the point. Like, I wasn't going to go full in. Like, okay, anyways. But this video, I was like, look, we're in character. Let's be in character. You know, like, let's not just, like, this will be fun. And we'll look back on this and be like, iconic. Like, this is a great video. And we did, and I love this video. And we also did one on your channel where we're just running around her house.
Like being crazy.
Using her cat boobie, and it was hilarious. And literally, Stassi's a cat named Boobie.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I was like, what's a cat boobie?
Using her cat boobies.
But literally, we stayed after for like an hour, and then we got to the party, and they were like, where were you guys? And we're like, oh, you'll see. And we showed them, showed them in the party when can't hear a word. And they like watched the whole thing, like intrigued, and you couldn't hear a single word of the dialect.
They were like, no way you guys just stayed there and did this for an hour while we're already at the party. Yes, good.
We sure did. And we'll do it again, honestly. It was very fun.
I mean, Halloween's a marathon. You got
it. What is going on, Noah? Don't ask questions. Just go with it.
Iceman is the coolest. Iceman? Like,
Too funny. Well, what about next year?
Ooh. We've got to come back and do something next year.
Oh, they weren't cheap. The from scratch full latex suits, like they weren't cheap. So I'm gonna be Mr. Incredible for 5 years in a row. No, I'll be Mr. Incredible. Next year I'm just gonna do my hair a bit differently. I'll be Dash. And then the year after, I'll be Jack, and I'll have a little. That'll be Miss Incredible and stuff it. You know?
Exactly. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
5 years right there. We got the whole family. Let's go back real quick. Where are you from?
North Carolina.
Okay.
Born and raised.
Born and raised. You went to school?
UNC, Chapel Hill.
Okay.
Where's that?
In North Carolina.
Okay.
In Chapel Hill, North Carolina.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Tar Heels. It's where Michael Jordan went. Please.
Please. 23. And then. When did you move out to LA?
In 2016.
How old were you?
21.
To pursue music.
Yep.
Did you
have a
set in stone career?
I didn't have a set in stone career yet.
You were interning.
But I was interning summers before I graduated.
Love that.
So I was coming out here for like 2 summers. And so when I came back, when I finally made the full move, I had an internship, but I wasn't paid.
Okay.
So, like, for the first, like, 6 months living here, I was still doing unpaid internships.
Was it hard to balance doing internships while you're doing school?
No, because when I did that, it was over summer. So, I would only come out here for, like, 2 months. So, it was, like, I would just do the internship, then go back, and school was fine.
Okay.
But it was definitely hard to balance when I first moved here because I was not making any money.
Right.
So, I actually took a job at Joy Rich. If you know Joy Rich, it's, like, the clothing store on Melrose. I worked at Joy Rich for, like...
In customer
service,
like in like a you
like literally like
cashier type stuff.
Yes,
love that.
And like helping people like get their.
You really
clothes.
Went like the traditional route, like when actors come out here with like an aspiring dream, they'll like work as a waiter, and it's like you see in the movie.
I love
your upbringing. I love it.
Hustled.
I love it.
And I really did, and like, I would never change that for anything. Even though that first year was tough, because like when you move out here and you're 21, all my friends are
scary.
Either in. They're all East Coast, so everyone's North Carolina or New York or DC. Mm. And I knew a few people out here, but I didn't have the friend group that I have back home or the friend group I have now,
right,
I was very, I felt like really alone a lot of the time, which was tough because I had such a strong unit back in North Carolina.
Right.
So that first year was kind of hard.
Okay. And then,
but yeah, then I got my assistant job. Oh, I told you, at Milk and Honey.
Oh,
and
right, the, right,
yeah,
right, right.
Yeah. And then, who'd you assist by?
Yeah. And then that sparked me. That was my door in.
That was your door in. And then, yeah, you go to Capitol.
Mm-hmm.
When did you know it's coming? Like, when you know it's coming. You know it's coming. When did you build this network? Like, when did you meet the friends that you are friends with now?
Or in simpler terms for the fans, when did you meet like Stas and Victoria?
Yes.
Like the friends that you probably call your best friends, yes, now to this day.
Well, yes, my girls.
Well, Victoria was in New York with us and she got to experience most of those things. She didn't come, yes, to the Harry concert, but aside from that,
mm-hmm, the three of us spent a lot of time together.
We were the trio in New, yeah, York, and I, mm-hmm, love Victoria.
She's the best.
I love her, and I love what we did in New York. It was so, yeah, fun, and it was genuinely like just good times with good people. And like,
yeah,
I learned a lot about both of you there,
mm-hmm,
and you guys learned a lot about me, and we just like clicked, and it was great. But that's when I kind of realized that you met Victoria first out of all of them, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Victoria's definitely like my ride or die, Victoria and Stas. But Vic and I met at a party, like literally at a day party.
LA.
That's so LA.
So LA.
But it's so funny because
y'all got matcha the next morning, huh?
We sure did. We literally met at a party and we were just like dancing. We were just dancing together. And we were just like, woo, what's your name?
Classic.
And literally, and then like we got each other's number, and I feel like that was probably, it was like October maybe that we met. And then literally come December, she was like, hey, we're all going to Tulum for New Year's. Do you want to come? And I was like, fuck yeah, I do. So I went to Tulum with, like, it was like me, Victoria, her sister Sophia, and a few other friends. And we just became inseparable ever since.
Okay, keep going.
And then from Vic.
Keep going.
She was friends with Stas at the time.
Yes, she was friends with Stas. But
touch on this. What did Vic do?
At the time, Vic was Kylie's assistant.
Kylie Jenner.
At the time.
Yeah.
Oh.
So Vic was still working with Kai, and then that's how I met Kylie. And then that's how I met Stas. And then, yes, we all became friends. And Vic no longer works for Kylie. And they're still besties.
Yeah. And Vic, from working with Kylie, has immersed into having what? Like a huge following as well.
Yeah, she's killing it.
She's killing it. And
she's killing it.
I think it's swimwear line,
yeah, doing her thing.
I think it's pretty amazing. Like, when people say, like, it's all about who you know, it's one of those things where it's like, yes and no. Like, you can know someone.
Mm-hmm.
And then what comes out of it? I think you're just so, you're just, almost wanting like him to close his ears because I'm about to hype him up. I just think you radiate such like a positive energy, and I think like, aww, it's like very attractive, not in that way. Like, it attracts good people around you. Mm-hmm. He thinks I'm attractive. No, I think you attract a very good crowd, and I think you're like, you're just such a good person to have around. And I think,
appreciate
like
that, Noah,
that brings so much value to, but basically what I was just trying to say, like, you can know these people,
yeah,
but like, do they want to keep hanging out with you? Does that actually matter that you know them? And it's right, like, it does if you bring value. Like, if you're a good person, like,
yeah,
that goes way further than anything else. Like, I, yeah, think if you're a genuine good person, people will, I don't know,
yeah,
be attracted to that. And it's like,
oh, I appreciate you saying,
yeah,
that.
Yeah, of course.
That's,
and
really
I think,
sweet of you.
I think it's one of those things where
I have butterflies in my stomach.
Oh, stop it.
We're crying over here.
But yeah, and I think that's put you in so many different rooms. And I think, yeah, that's just like how you continue to just kill it and like balance these two crazy lives, mm-hmm, in a sense that you have together as being the Carter B and then,
right,
Carter Gregory, the
A&R. Vice President, yeah, of the A&R, yeah.
But
it definitely is a balancing act,
I'm
say,
sure it is.
For and, sure.
Where do you go now from this? Because I kind of know what your dreams are.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to share them? Because I think they're, ooh, really interesting. Or is it one of those things where a magician doesn't share his secrets like that?
I mean, it's something that I just like, I want to internally manifest.
I love that. Okay, that's fine.
And hopefully it happens, so then it's like, oh, well, he made his dreams come true.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
But like, where do I go from here? I mean, I just want to keep...
Like, where do you see yourself?
I just want to keep working with the best artists that I can, and artists who want to change culture. That's something that's really big for me, is that being a black gay man from the South, which was not easy growing up in North Carolina, and knowing I was gay since I was like five.
B made me gay.
Also, you know what's so funny? My mom, story, I wanted to be Simba so bad for Halloween when I was like four. So bad. And
what?
My mom, like, there were no Simba costumes. They were all sold out. But there were Nala costumes. And so my mom got me a Nala costume.
That's when you knew.
And dressed me up as Nala. And she always says, she goes, well, I'm the one who made you gay in the first place. Because I put you in Nala. And I'm like, yeah, you did.
That's true. Sure,
but yeah, I just want, it's really important for me to work with artists who want to affect culture and yeah. make real change through their art. Because, you know, I love working with people who stand for something and have like a clear identity, and like who use their platform and use their voices to help other people.
Right.
It's like super important to me.
I love that. And I think another thing that is just overall so interesting, and I don't want this to turn into like some life lesson, but something you can take away from this podcast that I think is like been really important. And I don't know, I kind of live by this because my dad always told me growing up, like the biggest thing that when, this goes for anyone that's listening in their career, if you're 12 years old listening, like just remember this, and like it doesn't have to apply to you now, but I think it's one of those things where my dad would always tell me, you never know who's watching. And I think that's like such an important thing, because when I would play soccer, whether it was at a park by myself, kicking the ball around, you never know who's driving by. You never know like who's watching your games. And so like play like someone's watching. And I think that can apply to anyone in any vertical of someone's life.
Absolutely.
And I think it's so interesting because, I mean, another interesting thing that we talked about was, or that happened, was when we were in New York, we were shopping. And I don't know if you remember that. You definitely remember this, but
what happened?
You'll remember it. But Carter and I were walking by. We were just shopping in New York in like the Soho East Village area. And there was this guy on the side of the road.
Oh, the amazing dude.
Super a talented, like a guy, just guitar, his guitar case opened up, like the cliche thing that you would see, like the side street act. But usually these people, I mean, it's just amazing that people stand out here, and like we even talked to him, and they're like, he's here all the time. And it's like,
and he was insane.
Really good.
So good.
Good enough that VP A&R of Capital went up and talked to him and asked him, like, do you have, like, you, it was really cool to sit back and watch, because I was like, this guy's really cool. He like has it too. Like something about him like had
his
it.
Whole vibe was sick.
So cool. And I was like, you should go talk to him. And you're like, I will. And you went up and talked to him, and it was cool just like sitting back and seeing this interaction of like, I don't know. It was like a potential like could career in the making.
It was
potential, like you could change that. And like, it was just really cool to see. And so that's where that whole message of like, you never know who's watching, and like, doesn't have to be music. It doesn't have to be anything like in particular. It's just,
you never know. It's just crazy to think.
Yeah.
Cause
you also never know, like no matter what field you're in, line of work you decide to go into, how you can kind of be a leader or help affect someone younger than you who wants to do something that you're also doing. Because I'll never forget, I was at, and I'm sure you've experienced this, but I was at Coachella this past year, and this kid came up to me and he was like, hey, he was like, I know you're Carter, I know you're like an A&R, and he was like, I just want to let you know that like I really want to be an A&R, and I'm like also gay, and like to see you like flourishing and working with so many incredible artists, like as a gay music executive, like that, it like really inspires me and lets me know that I can do it too.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, like that's like, that to me was like, that's amazing. And that goes like beyond like all like just the work of it. It's just like
someone's watching.
Yeah. And watching, and you're helping someone, like you're showing someone else, hey, if I can do it, so can you.
Yeah. Like, and it's I think that's like beautiful to think. And that can also, I think, lead to some kind of pressure in a sense. Like when you know that you have people watching you, it's like, oh my God, I can't mess up. But
yeah,
that's like the beauty of being
a human,
flawless. I mean, flawed creatures.
Yes.
Us humans, you know, like we're going to make mistakes. And I think it's how
Beyonce flawless.
Duh.
B.
I hate to break it to you. I think B is even flawed too. You know, it's one of those things.
I mean,
I hate to say it. She might have flaws.
Let's not go so far to say let's flawed.
I'm sure B in her life has made mistakes, but it's just crazy to think that, like, I don't know. Someone's always watching, and it could it could be in a way that, I don't know. It's just super crazy to think.
That's super inspirational that your dad said that.
Yeah, I love that. He like ingrained that into me at a young age, and that's why like every training, every game that I played in, like you always.
You just I haven't met your dad.
Haven't.
I need to. I mean, considering I'm his son-in-law, so it's like I need to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyways.
Okay. On to the next.
Let's end it on a fun note.
That's. Yeah. So that's Carter Gregory.
I feel like we've learned you guys. So much.
I genuinely,
like more than
I
I've learned. Like I've learned any so other much podcast
about myself. I didn't even know it was like in the old noggin.
Do you have any? Do you have anything else that is just like one last takeaway that people, you know, when they think of Carter Gregory, what should be attached to your name?
Oh my god!
You know, before we get into this game, we
what should be attached to my name?
Anything you want to get off your chest? You know,
sexy, chocolatey, scrumptious.
Keep going.
I mean,
yeah. Talk your shit.
What would be attached to my name? I'm just a fun loving, happy guy.
There you go.
Love that.
That was good.
We love
who cares about his friends?
Period.
And family, and Noah.
Duh.
That's for last.
I love that. All right, now we got a game.
Okay, let's play.
So we're playing Deal or No Deal.
Oh my god, I love how inclusive this already is. Great.
Imagine each of these models are... Okay, imagine each of these models are your dream guy or girl, but they have one trait about them that sets them apart from being a 10 out of 10. Click on each case to find out if the model's trait is either a deal or a no deal for you.
This is like that TikTok, like, he's a 10, but...
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's like a spinoff of that.
This but they're all 10s. I guess you could say.
Okay, so yeah, these are all 10s, but then there's,
but there's something that's
like
great.
Because there's 10 out of 10s out there. I'm sure we're in LA, like there are a lot of beautiful people walking around.
Uh-huh.
But there are things about these people that are, maybe something's like an ick to you. Maybe it's like, oh, they're hot, but like, no, but, stay away, you know? Okay. So
but
it's
their
like.
Their feet stink, yeah.
Yep.
I can't stand
that's yeah.
Feet. That's a good one. This I did make this inclusive for you too.
Love that.
So you are more than welcome to answer these as well.
Yeah, you have to.
I'll answer for the guys too. All
right, what's our first case we're picking?
Do I get to pick?
Yeah.
Lucky number 8. Wait, do I have to pick a guy?
You're lucky number 8?
No. I'm 8's my favorite number.
It's my favorite number.
Is it really?
Number 8 has been my jersey number for
my whole life. I mean, obviously. I told you it was love at first sight.
Yes, 8 has been my number my whole life.
Same. Never changed.
2 times Beyonce's favorite number. 4.
Oh my god, it is.
Why did I not know that?
Come on now.
9, 4, 8, 1, her birthday.
You go 4 then. You go 4.
No, no, I'm 8.
Oh, we're doing 8. Case 8.
Love B, but I'm 8.
I love. Okay, they're all both 10. 8's a girl, though.
Oh, one sec. We're having a little.
I'm gay. Boys.
Boy.
Case number 8. They're dead set. On not having kids.
10 out of 10, I'm with you.
Adoption included.
We don't need to have kids. Oh, that's so dark. I feel bad. But I've been... Something's going on lately. Literally within, like, the last, like, 2 months, I've always thought that I wanted, like, 3 kids. But, like, within the last 2 months, I've been like, ugh.
How old are you?
Do I want kids?
For the people, how old are you?
How do I look?
You want me to answer this?
Yeah. Because I'm only 19.
Right.
I'm really shy. No, I'm 27.
Okay, 27. Do you think you're getting to that? I don't want to scare you. But
what?
Like, I want kids.
I know you want kids.
Now.
Oh,
I'm ready.
No, I'm kidding. Honestly, you'd be a great dad really soon. I know you want kids. I don't know. I feel like I'm going through like a weird...
I feel like you'll get... I feel like you'll hit a point in your life where you're like, I've done a lot. And like, I feel like you'll get to a point where you'll get bored and you'll be like, I need kids.
If I'm going to have kids, then I'm going to be like 45.
Mm.
Like it's truly no time soon for me.
Fair enough.
I'm not there mentally.
Okay. But dead set. If you know that you will eventually like in later on in the future,
but he's
you'll
a
want,
10 and he doesn't want
he doesn't
any
want
kids.
Them at all. Like, we'll never grow out of this. Like, you know that sometime in the future, just not right now, you'll want kids. Are you okay with your partner not wanting him?
But he's a 10.
Not even adopting.
Oh, I know.
But he's a 10.
Okay, well, I'm going to be with him. But then if I ever, if I change at 45, then I'll just be like, sorry, we have to break up. And I'll have my kids.
There you
but
go.
He'll probably love me so much that he'll, do just, that he'll want to stay with me, so.
Okay, so that was a no deal,
that's
right?
That's a no deal.
Okay, I guess
me.
That's a no deal.
I want God. Kids.
Jesus. Yeah, what's our next case?
I'll go 16. I'll double the 8. I'll go to the homie up there on the left.
The light-skinned poppy.
He is...
He's probably like Latino or something.
Oof. Their parents are massive Trump fans. They're not, but their parents.
But their parents are? I'm sticking with them.
Please.
Please. I don't care. Oh, but that's, I don't... So, that's messed up. No, you guys, I do care. I do care. I'm just saying, if he's not, like... No, like, everyone's allowed to have their opinion.
Right, but...
We don't have to hang with the parents besides at Thanksgiving.
Right.
Just like...
Once a
we
year.
We just won't talk politics at the table.
I think politics has ruined so many things.
So many
it's
things.
It's just like... But the emphasis on massive in front is just like... I think massive anything just gets annoying.
Are people going to be mad at me? I'm not like a Trump apologist whatsoever. Trump is bad.
No, but that's like, it's like your man isn't a fan.
Yeah, exactly.
You can't
that's what
hold
I'm saying.
Him a,
I can't hold him accountable for his parents.
Yeah.
Our parents grew up in different times.
Right.
It's a mature thing to say.
Yeah. I'm very mature.
You are.
Thank you.
Because I see so many TikToks about like, it's so funny when like, I see a TikTok and it's like, it'll be a guy and with like a text overlay and I don't know the exact sound, but it's him saying when your friend's over and your dad says something like really borderline racist. Oof. And it's like,
oof.
It's like, all right, let's settle down.
Yeah,
there.
Yeah,
it's
yeah,
like,
yikes. Yikes, yeah, that's
but
bad.
It's so like,
yeah,
funny. Just like the different, yeah, different times for sure.
Different times.
Different times. All right. Next case.
Oh, was it yeah. My? Okay, now we'll do Beyonce 4.
Beyonce 4.
I keep choosing all the women. Am I actually gay?
I'm choosing the guy.
I know, hey.
Little switch.
We all know.
Shut up. Everyone knows.
Oof. It's Harry Styles, but you're not allowed to go to any of his shows anymore.
Wait, so the guy's Harry
Did
Styles?
Did you create these mm-hmm. prompts?
Awesome.
Oh, I love that.
Okay. I don't give a fuck about the shows. Harry's mine. Let's go. Easy deal.
Never going to show again.
I'm never going to. Why do I need to? He's coming.
Show.
He's coming home to me.
Yeah, please.
You guys can watch his 15 nights at Forum. He's going back to my bed.
True.
He's here for. It's like you guys can see his 15 months, but he's got a month here. Like he's
literally,
coming,
he's coming.
I get
home
him for
me.
30 days. You guys yeah. get him for 15.
Like we'll be in Portofino together. He'll give me a show there.
You make him sing in bed.
Exactly, and I would make him hit those high notes. Let me tell you.
So that's a deal.
That was definitely a deal.
What did I say?
What did you say?
Yeah, what did you say? You would totally.
Yo,
please.
Come on.
So you could
you know.
Hang with Harry
I mean,
every day.
Harry. That's
skipping
what I'm saying.
The shows.
That's why I said deal.
And you've seen them like.
Yeah, I'll just watch them on
times.
My phone.
Literally.
I've seen them.
Too funny.
I've gone to a fair share.
What was that TikTok you did? It's just men. Like, yeah, I know
but
I'm scared.
Yeah. It's like, oh my God.
Next case.
10.
They need food to be incorporated into sex every once in a while.
Oh,
fire.
Fun. Yeah.
Fire.
A little whipped cream on the nipple.
But like, it's giving
yeah,
like...
To like what extent?
Two, three food? Times a month, maybe.
Like wings. Like...
Everything. Sushi.
Have you ever seen Sex in the City?
It's sushi.
I mean, hot.
Yeah.
I would totally eat sushi like...
Who gets to choose the food?
They do, not
do
you.
Do they have like weird cravings?
Yeah, as long as it's not like curry.
I'm thinking they're down with anything.
Like they got like garlic naan just like slapping you with it.
Ugh.
It's like, what?
Sick. Sick.
Like, tonight's like, Twizzlers.
Fire.
Twizzlers, that's easy. You can put those guys anywhere.
Fuck up.
Tonight's pho.
Like, yeah, see like that?
Yeah. No.
I mean, I'm down to incorporate. Food a little bit. I've actually never done
every
that
once
before.
In a while. Deal.
I've never done anything yeah. with food
deal.
Before. But yeah, deal.
Cool.
You haven't?
No. Whoa.
No.
So wait, what? That was a deal.
Deal.
Nice.
All right, Carter. What's your number?
18.
18. All right. They have multiple tattoos with their ex-boyfriend or girlfriend's names.
That's a little creepy. Ooh. So, I mean, I guess Pete does it.
What if they lie to you about it, too? What if they're like, oh, it's my mom?
And then I find out that it's not?
Yeah.
Oof. I mean,
oof.
Oh, multiple tattoos? That's a little creepy.
Yeah, not just one.
Like, it's, how many relationships have you had?
I think at least three guys' names are going to be on this body.
Weird.
That's weird to me.
I think that's like...
A red flag to
no,
me.
Yeah, no tea, no shade to anyone that does that, I guess. But it's like, it's not, no, I don't want that.
Yeah, it's a little much. It's a little much for me. Because I'm just like, why do you get all the names tatted? And then like, why is it still not working out?
Yeah.
Seems a little crazy. I'm going to say no deal on that one.
Love it.
It's giving toxic. Like it's
giving toxic. But no shade to anyone who wants to get their partner's name tatted on.
Yeah.
Live your life.
Go off.
All right, next case.
Not off near me. 12. She looks cute.
No, she does look so happy.
She's radiating.
Oof. They'll throw their drinks in your face anytime you guys get into a fight, small or large.
No deal.
Don't care.
Nope.
No deal. Grow up.
No way.
Grow up.
No.
Learn how to communicate.
Nothing physical. That type of aggression. No way. Absolutely not.
It's Harry Styles. But punches you in the face, but spits on you every time you get in an argument.
That's a twist.
Hey, spit's kind of hot, whatever.
True.
More. Oh my god, Harry spit on me again.
You just make him mad on purpose?
As soon as he spits on me. This is getting really crazy. Really
he may see
so
this.
So much Harry talk. Like, god, we're obsessed.
You're obsessed. Uh-huh. It's weird.
All right, next case.
Two.
Giving anime.
Oh my god, it is giving
she has no face. They talk about their love for their dad all the time.
That's cute, though. Maybe they have a really close relationship. You just did.
But, like, what if it's, like, 24-7?
Like, all the time?
Like, all the time?
Like, right before you get into bed.
Okay, well, nah, that's no. Not gonna... That's gonna be a boner kill.
That'll be a... I mean...
I don't want to be thinking about your daddy.
Can go either
unless
way.
Unless he's sexy, too.
Can go either way.
I'm like, yeah, let's talk about your dad.
Nah. Oh, that was number one. We should, might as well just do number one.
We'll do number one.
Okay, two was no deal. We're not doing dad.
No
talk
deal.
Like
number one was they still.
If you talk about anyone all the time, it's still just like.
Yeah, fan.
Fan behavior.
Would you rather be with them than me? You know, if they're gonna talk about them.
Oh,
that much.
Right.
Yeah.
Like. Ew.
They still pick their boogers. Keep in mind, 10 out of 10. But they make...
What do you mean? What do you mean? What environment?
They're not eating their boogers.
I'm going to try to make this a little easier. They're not eating their boogers.
Great.
They're just simply picking and putting down. But you may be a catch and they're doing this.
Putting down where? And are they putting in a napkin?
Napkin under the table, maybe on the jean.
On the jean?
Is it like how often are they picking it? Like, is it like a, like, that's a big thing. Like, if it's like a once a day, like, I'll pick a winner, babe, like that kind of thing. It's like,
I mean, I pick my booger every now and then when I'm alone in my bathroom. Or Noah's bathroom.
This is like,
police,
in public.
You look in the mirror
and if you see a little booger,
yeah, it's like,
you're going to get it. Yeah, of course.
But yeah, if I'm sitting at dinner at Catch, I'm not picking my.
So this can go either way.
And if you have to, you'll excuse yourself to go to the bathroom and pick your boogers in there.
I think it's something that can be taught. I think it's a habit that can be broken. I'll be like, hey, let's just work on that, you know?
I'm going to teach you.
Just because you're
hot. But I like it. Okay, Pete, so that was a deal?
That's a deal.
Yeah, because we'll get them to grow out of it.
We're accepting.
Okay.
Get them to grow out of it.
Next case.
Grow up.
Let's go 14.
You with the anime girls.
Oh my god, I keep... Oh my, I just, you know I love anime.
They ribbit like a frog in bed, but are capable of giving you the best head of your life.
Deal. Ribbit all day long. Deal.
It's a real toss-up.
I mean, what? Dying. Best of your life? You know.
He's like, I'll ribbit, take ribbit, it.
Ribbit, it's just the ribbit. Way you like him.
But that wouldn't, like, at all, like,
turn you off in any.
I think I would just get used to it. I'd be like, oh, this is like their, this is their moan.
True.
Ribbit. You're really thinking about
it. I know.
Right? You are really dead set. Like, you're okay with someone ribbiting in your bed.
Absolutely.
Carter.
Noah.
Like.
Did, the toss-up, though, best head of your life.
I understand that.
Ribbiting in bed.
Like, oh, please. You don't care about ribbits.
I think I do.
Really?
I think I do, yeah.
Will that just, like, bring you out of it?
I think so. Like, I feel like I can't turn it off easily. Like, I feel like...
You'd be like, stop. None of that.
What if she offered, like, a different farm animal noise?
Mm.
Like a moo.
Moo. She's baaing on my shit. She's oinking on my shit. No, I think that's a no deal for me.
Wow.
Yeah.
Noah is not inclusive of the farm animals.
I think I can go elsewhere for her.
That was right.
Here, the second part.
We're going to go right to three.
Okay.
They're as ripped as a bodybuilder.
I mean, your preference. You want a guy that is...
I definitely like a guy who's got a build,
for
sure.
You like a masked man, right?
Yeah, but I don't... Bodybuilder's a little too much for me.
Define bodybuilder.
So have you seen Killer Sally?
No.
Yeah. It's a new documentary on Netflix about this woman who kills her husband who's a bodybuilder. She's also a bodybuilder. So like, imagine the type of guys that are... Yeah. Well, that's what it was.
Like...
It was road rage.
We're talking about like Arnold back in the day.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a little too much for
me. Like...
It's too much
for competitions.
Yeah, like I... Like, it's so hard.
I could get
like,
down with a guy like one time, you know?
Of course.
Yeah. For you, though. For a girl, I don't, there's something about like being a, like imagine if I were a straight guy doing it with a girl that was that ripped.
Yeah, how does that make you feel?
I mean, go off, but like.
Go off.
Like, yeah. It's not going to make me think any less of myself. Like, I love a girl that's like determined and, you know, put her, like, I know how much work goes into like working out and keeping a,
especially body,
but like not with me. No, that's not my type.
You're not ready to be a bottom.
Like, if no. She's like, Noah, look, I want to
Noah,
reverse,
we
like,
can say it here first. Noah is not a bottom. He's told me he would top many a time.
Whatever,
we've gone over it through here too.
Like, okay, just great. Think about, well, it, no. if she's somehow has this spontaneous idea, she's like, let's switch roles tonight. What am I going to say? I can't say no.
Switch roles and like she's gonna peg you?
Like, what if I'm like, no, and she's like, shut up and bend it.
Like, yes, ma'am.
Right.
Ooh, yikes.
I'm not risking that. I don't want that.
Scary.
But praise to the girls that do that. It's just not my type.
Okay. Number 17.
That's fine.
They'll never.
Absolutely not.
They'll never let you have the aux cord in the car.
Absolutely not.
That person, though.
Yeah, I'm the one.
He is the one.
I'm the one who's not going to let you have the aux cord.
He's full-time aux. I could care less. I just let me get a request here and there if your music's trash.
Yeah, that's a no deal for me.
Does that suck when you're playing like aux and you love the songs you're playing and then someone else in the car is like, can I like cue up a song or two?
I hate his music.
Because for me, I hate it. Oh.
No, he only plays B, and I love B. But she sends me the unreleased stuff that he doesn't have, so I'll be like, let me send you.
Less. I mean, no, if someone wants to queue up, like, a song, like, I'll play, like, 15 seconds of it, but then we're back to my...
That's me.
You good now?
I'm like, crack.
I could never be with someone who's like, it's only their aux, because what if they have terrible music taste?
Yeah, country.
We just can't. Oh, well, I like some country.
What if it's only country?
Yeah, but we can't. No,
I love
country. I can't ride with you.
I love country. I think country is great.
Yeah, that's a no deal for me. I guess.
I just love all kinds of music. So I'm like, I'm up for it. You know,
that was good for that. Wow.
But I'm game. You know, it's like, well, we'll just take separate cars. I'll meet you there.
I'll be like, this is my Uber. You have to get your own.
I'll meet you there.
Yeah.
So that was a no deal.
That's a deal for me. That's a deal for me.
Deal for now and no deal for me.
We're going to put Carter's answers on the board.
Yeah, because he chose that one.
Oh, right. Your turn. Right,
I'll go five. One. I'll go five.
Number five. What's the song? Mambo, number five.
Mambo.
There we go. They're 7-1 and a billionaire.
Please, he's eating that up.
Like, is that a question? Fire.
This is one that I had a feeling you might have a little more trouble with.
Yeah.
If
no,
she
I'm
was
good.
7'1", but she's a billionaire. I'm good. What if it was trillionaire?
I'm good. I'm set. I got.
Noah doesn't want to be carried like a baby. They'd pick you
yeah.
up.
Yeah, money. Like They'd it's one of those things. You. Like, money isn't everything. So
yeah.
I can
yeah,
tell
money
us
definitely.
About that.
I think 7'1" part is hot.
Yeah, you don't
want to get picked up. 7'1".
You don't want to get picked up and pinned Noah, against the wall,
no.
right? And like Noah, you're like wrapping your legs around her.
Please. Oh, that's good sex.
That's reminding me of like all of the from the Drake album, all of the Drake memes that are going crazy. Like, they're so good.
So good.
21. Can you do something for me?
How do you think he's like reacting to that shit?
He probably eats it up.
I feel like he finds
it
hilarious.
I hope so.
Yeah.
No, I didn't see it. What was it?
He was not laughing.
Really?
He wasn't like mad. He wasn't mad, but he was just like, y'all think you're funny. Like, nah.
I think it's hilarious.
No, I think Drake.
I mean, he's so
good at what he does.
And he's so nice. Like, I feel like he does it.
He wouldn't care. Like, Drake is literally like, he knows, he's so smart. He knows, like, he knows that there would be a meme with that probably. He knows that people would, like, play into it. And he knows that would do better for, like, with the fake, it's just crazy. Yeah.
This is case number 6. They'll only stay with you if it's an open relationship. Ooh. Don't forget, 10
Carter,
out of 10.
Answer this.
I mean, I personally am of an open mind to open relationships. And I also think in the gay community, open relationships are more frequent than perhaps in the heterosexual community.
Very.
Well put.
So I'm not against it. That's not a deal breaker for me.
I love it. And Noah?
Look,
we've talked about this.
Yeah, no, I'm too... It's definitely a no deal for me. I'm just trying to think of like my reasoning. I think I'm just too emotionally like... I don't want to say intelligent. Like, I'm just more like... I couldn't do that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, if I'm with someone, I'm all in with them.
Yeah.
And it's like, I have all of myself to give to them and I don't want them giving any less to me and being like, if I'm all in for them and they're, you know,
sharing
with another person, it's like, oh.
Yeah.
It just like, if there's, even if it's agreed upon, I still would find it as cheating.
Yeah.
And I couldn't do that. So yeah. I'm gonna say no deal. I still don't understand how it is accepted. How it's like,
it's so normal.
It's so normal in
so normal.
It's like
the gay
why
community, and I don't understand.
Yeah.
I don't get how you can do it.
Yeah.
We have it best of both worlds.
We really
I have it all.
We
I
really have it all.
Everyone should be gay. They keep asking to have a threesome with another guy or girl.
That's totally fine with me.
I think
not a deal breaker for me.
And I'm dating.
Okay, wait.
And I'm dating this person.
Yes. To make it harder for you, what if it's a girl?
I'm
some insecurity there.
No, I mean, I'm open to it. I just don't think that I would necessarily be like into it.
What if he was like, I'm gonna need to see you.
What
insert.
If he was more into the girl though? Like, what if you?
I think I would maybe. I might find that kind of hot.
Yeah.
Like
odd.
I'd find
odd
it
behavior.
Odd. Yeah.
No, but it's
I'm
like
weird.
No, I get it. The second though, he's like, I'm gonna need you to do the deed.
I don't think that I just don't.
Scary.
Yeah.
Like, maybe I'm a little like, no, because I know I'm not. I was gonna say,
what if it was you and two girls?
Like, look, maybe I'm a little vanilla, and like, maybe I'm just not like vanilla. It's more like,
what if it was you and two girls?
I'm all in for my partner. I could care. Please, like, I could care less
that. But what if she came to you and she was like, this would really excite me.
And, like, make me happy.
And make me so happy.
And, like, would that not be fun for you?
I'm sure. I'm, like...
Hey, these are questions that may come up at some point.
Oh, I know.
Right, like, if you're in a long-term relationship, no, it's been 8 years, and you're both like, oh, my God, like, how much more can we take? Let's spice it up a little bit.
Yep.
Yeah, I know. And I guess it's hard to... put into perspective right now, just because it's like right now I'm at a point in my life where I'm so invested into like, if I'm in a relationship, I'm all in
that one.
And like,
yeah.
I totally love that. And like, I'm
picky with who I get in a relationship with. So it's like, if I am in a relationship with someone, I love that person for all of them.
Yeah.
And it's like,
you're such a good guy.
If this were to come about, I would think it was a test. And I'm not failing that test. Mm-hmm. And I'm gonna be like, no, like, I want to be with you. But if she's persistent on like, this would really make me happy.
This is not a test. This is like something I want to do.
Right. Yeah.
I understand that, but I don't. Is it bad to ask like, why do you want this? Like,
no, I don't think that's bad at all.
Yeah, no.
Right.
And I think she can fully
if
explain.
If she talks me into it,
yeah.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
What is it? Isn't there like a whole kink of being in a relationship but seeing your other partner?
Yes.
A cuck. Like,
that's what I'm saying.
So that's like a cuck. Yeah. Isn't it a cuckold or something?
Because like, it could be a real turn on for her to watch you with another
right.
girl. Like that could be. But she's in the room though. So it's not like nothing shady's happening.
I am cheating at that point. I
no,
feel.
No, you're not though.
I cannot be.
But you're having the experience with her.
Right,
so it's,
right,
you're not
right.
cheating because she's
with you. I'd be staring
you.
At her the whole time. Right. Like, I'm not loving this.
Hey, you could.
You could.
There'd be like very, like I would sit her down and be like, look, so you're comfortable. There are boundaries. Like I'm not going to like, if she looks
like,
over and I'm like enjoying it, it's like.
This. But she may, that may like.
There's so many.
Be a turn on for no, her
I
watching you enjoy it.
I don't think I could do it.
All right.
He's such a good boy.
There are other times like. So many fish in the sea where it's like either I will find another girl for me that won't persist on threesomes.
Yes. Yes.
All right, next one.
15.
They're an actress on a raunchy HBO show in which they have to be fully naked in a lot of scenes.
Who cares? So, yeah, like I do not care. That's cool. I love it. My partner's
it's
on
art.
My partner's on HBO. Like, are you kidding me? If my partner's in like Euphoria and they're naked, I'm like, that's mine.
Yep.
Love it. See you at the premiere, babes.
Preach.
Is this? You don't like this?
I don't know.
I did this one because I had a feeling he was gonna
be
a little.
Oh my God, Noah!
I don't know. Well, this is
yes, Sydney Sweeney. Come on.
No, but I think I see where you could be coming from in the sense like it's a little weird that like.
Well, this is the thing. I don't want anyone watching this being like, this kid is so like it's not like it's not coming from an insecure place. Trust me, it's not, and it's not coming from like a possessive
Noah's
place.
No, so controlling.
Please, like no, it's just like. But it comes to a point where it's like it's not you writing the script, and it's like you're like this is your job. Mm. So it's like part
yes,
of me is
job.
Like go for it, like I right. don't care. Mm-hmm. But then also part of me is like, yeah, I don't have a big problem with it.
Yeah.
You know?
Especially, I mean, it's HBO. It's going to be
acting.
It's acting.
Yeah.
It's going to be great.
It's an art form.
It's acting. Because, like now I think of it, I don't care.
There you go.
Have you guys watched, what's the new show? Hulu. Tell Me Lies. Tell Me Lies.
No. A lot of
have you
sex
watched
in
it?
That?
A lot of sex in that.
Oh my gosh.
But it's like, yeah, I mean, it's. The nudity is like needed for the story. It's not like they're just being nude for shock value. It's like
no,
well, it's needed for
hold
to
on,
really
no,
get the story across.
Yeah.
No, I don't believe that you would be fully okay seeing your boyfriend. In a show. Like fully getting it on with someone else.
I would be fully okay with it because I've been in that situation before. My boyfriend has been on a show where he has had a play a. Straight guy.
Was it hard?
Not in the slightest.
Straight guy kissing a girl?
Full, like sex scene, basically.
What if it was a guy?
What if it was
like Elite? What if he was on Elite?
Ooh, Elite. I feel like I would definitely, there'd be like, of course, there'd be like a hint of like, damn. Like, did you like that? Like, and you guys had to film it so many times.
Yeah.
But it would never be a point of like contention for me.
Yeah.
Because that's their line of work and that's like what they're like and I want them to be successful. Mm. But of course it'd be a part of me being if I'm dating someone and he's like making out with Manu, I'm like, I'd probably feel a little insecure because I'm just like, damn, Manu's so beautiful. Like, how was that for you? You still want to make out with me?
Did you enjoy that experience?
Yeah, literally. Of course it'd be a level of that, but...
You guys gonna fight? Sorry, I'm not Manu.
I know, literally. You want Manu right now.
I know. Oh, that is tough. Because it's like... I feel like that's a thing that only actors can understand. And mm-hmm. I feel like actors, to a point, like...
I feel it's so hard to try to explain, or as someone who's dating an actor, to understand like what it's like. I don't know. It's such a weird thing, because I feel like actors can come from the same place and be like, look, I had to film this sex scene last week. And they're like, oh, same. And it's like, oh, but at the end of the day, we're still coming back to each other. And it's like,
of course,
acting is our job. Mm-hmm. But I feel like it could create some kind of tension almost, or even bring up issues in the relationship. If like,
that's why you have to be stable. You've got to be,
you have to
open line trust of communication.
Is,
you have to
trust and communication secure. Is the biggest thing, but it's mm-hmm. like, it is hard. Like, let's say an actor goes and dates a waitress somewhere, mm-hmm. and she's seeing that. It's like,
I understand what you're saying.
I don't know. I feel like some people may not understand it.
It can definitely bring up a level of insecurity, for sure.
Because for the actor, it's not, they didn't go to the director and be like, can I please have this sex right. scene? Like, I really want, like.
That's why I just think it's.
In the script.
It's within your relationship to, you know,
give each
other those words
like
of affirmation.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I feel like there's a lot of responsibility on the person having the so-called sex scene to like do a lot of reassuring that same day when they come back home.
Yeah.
Like, hey, I had to film this, but don't worry. Like,
yeah.
I feel like that's needed, that reassurance.
I also feel like me having been in that situation, I've just like, I mean, I like matured through it. And now I'm like, okay, yeah, it's not going to really bother me.
Yeah, like it's so easy to sit here and be like, I wouldn't care. Like one of those, like it's like, I'm secure. Like it doesn't matter. But then like, you'd be robot not to be like,
yeah,
a little, oh, that like kind of hurt.
You know? Yeah, doing that.
Yeah. It's so human to be seeing the person you're in love with.
Of course. You're going to have some sort of reaction to it.
Like, that hurt, but
you will have a reaction.
Yeah, it's tough.
But definitely not a deal breaker.
Let's speed round these last three. We are at the 2-hour mark.
Oh my God.
I've cranked it.
You're going to be our longest episode ever.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Are people going to watch 2 hours?
The people usually like want the 2-hour episode.
Do they really want 2 hours?
The viewer retention is like, they watch for like 5 minutes.
Yeah, they're like, okay, well, we're kind of over
this
guy.
This sucks.
Like, oh my God. Please.
Let's go to 9.
No, it's been fun.
They used to date Childish Gambino.
Fire. Free tickets. We're hanging. Absolutely.
Why Childish Gambino? Is there like...
I wanted to pick someone that wasn't like beyond popular, but wasn't like beyond not popular. So like...
Could care less.
Someone he's like... sick. Yeah.
Yeah, someone
love
cool.
It. Absolutely.
There wouldn't be a threat level there.
No.
Okay. All right, 13 or 11?
Should we save 13 for last? Yeah, let's go 11.
They always talk with a baby voice in front of your parents.
Ooh, I hate that.
Can't do that.
Red. I hate that. My parents would be annoyed. They'd be like, why can't we have a conversation with your partner? Like, I don't know. I'm sorry.
They only do it when you're around
Gaga.
And then I'm like, wait, guys, I don't know. And then I start talking like it. It's all bad. No, that's a deal breaker. No.
No, can't do that.
Okay, good.
No.
13. They watch all of the Star Wars movies once a month.
Oh, fire. I'll be there cute. With them.
Okay, but like, are we talking 1 through 6 or are we talking 1 through however many there are now?
Let's exclude the TV shows and just say the movies. So is it 9?
I think it's 9.
So like, let's say 1 through.
I could be wrong.
But like,
once a month? Okay.
It's happening 12 times a year.
Okay, personally, fact for me, I watch one of the Harry Potter movies at least once or twice a month.
Really?
Yeah.
I think like
because they help me fall asleep. Pretty similar. They help me fall asleep.
Yeah. Okay.
So like I always put one on.
That's like people watching The Office every day.
Right.
That they've already seen.
Yeah. Like, so yeah. I'm like I don't. That's yeah. That won't bother me that much. Do I have to sit there and watch?
I was just about to say, do you have to be with them or could it be like, hey, you cool down, go watch your Star Wars. Yeah, I'm gonna be over here.
Yeah. I can't sit through all the Star Wars.
I guess I was thinking like imagining there's a night where you're like really wanting to watch like a fun show with your partner and then your partner
like a Star Wars night.
I gotta put my Star Wars.
We have to watch episode
3. All right, no stress.
Right.
It's been 4 years. I'm gonna go to this TV over here.
Right. I'm just like, yeah, watch it. I'm gonna like do some
more. I'll be on my laptop.
It's fine. Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe it's just a tick they have.
Like how many times can we watch Phantom Menace?
Revenge of the Sith. Come on, please.
Wow. All right. Well, so that was a deal.
Yeah, we can do that.
Okay.
That's a deal.
We'll take
Star Wars night, Harry Potter night, it's fine.
I think these are pretty, for the most part, I think these are pretty relatable answers that we've given. We thought of each one. We kind of talked through it.
Mm-hmm. Yep. We got best of the both worlds, a gay perspective, a straight perspective.
Yeah. And we agreed on most of them. I think there were a couple in the beginning that I was like, no. Like,
yep. You're like, Carter, you're weird.
What was it? Oh, the animal noises, please.
Oh, yeah, the ribbit.
Please.
Ribbit all night long, baby.
You just saw best out of your life and you were like, please.
Ribbit.
Do whatever you want for the best out of my life.
Oink, mooing, who cares? Quack.
Yeah, you can... can bring the farm books. I'm playing them. I don't care.
Like, what's tonight?
Yeah.
Oh shit.
As long as you wear the ears, wear the tail, and everything.
Oh, that's too much.
You know, I've never actually watched you and Larray before.
It's fine.
Wow. No shade. No. So this is like
I don't.
Awesome.
I don't expect my friends that are like in the industry to like consume like my content, and I like sometimes forget that like sometimes maybe people do.
Yeah.
I find it odd. Like, I'm like, don't watch my stuff.
But I love it. I mean, I've seen it, but right. I haven't watched, like,
if we're cool friends, thing. Like, you shouldn't watch my stuff.
I should not?
No, I'm joking.
Like, I watch your TikToks.
I don't expect you to sit through a two-hour episode of my podcast of me and Larray.
Yeah, but I like, love you riffing. Both, and this was so much fun.
Right, and I love that.
Yeah,
thank you for coming on.
I'm like gonna start coming. Actually, you know what we're gonna do? We're gonna add a little Carter here too. Okay. Carter, Noah, and
little asterisk.
Please, yeah. I feel like I'm like Ellen. Well, wait, hold on.
I'm Ellen.
You're Ellen, but I'm like sitting in. You know how people sit in for her show?
Yeah.
Yeah, like that vibe. I love it.
The co-host.
I love James Corden. I love James Corden.
Yes, Ellen.
Probably Jimmy Fallon. All of them have their all of them have things that I just love about them.
Yeah.
But like
that's very fun.
Yeah, very fun. But. I don't know. I felt like I've learned something from this conversation.
Me too.
Genuinely. And like, I love that. And
oh, I'm sure the fans did too.
I'm sure you guys, if you haven't,
I learned a lot.
Sorry. Yeah. Like, but I'm sure you guys have learned something. And
I
love a conversation that you leave and you're like, I'm glad we had that.
Me too.
And when you have guests on.
I'm very appreciative that you had me on.
Of course.
Yes. Very fun.
Thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you.
Love
guys.
This. Yeah.
Put a sock in it. Please.
Put a sock in it, please. But yeah. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you enjoyed this episode, give it a big thumbs up. Like,
subscribe.
Subscribe, turn on those post notifications. What should they comment?
Koa for life.
Comment that. And Koa. Whatever else you have to say. And yeah, that's about it.
We'll see you next week.
See you next time.
Love you guys.